actually, most of the times, if you look at MidJourney, definitely creates much crisper, highly detailed, much more realistic results than Adobe Firefly. But then again, you also have to look at the amount of things that it has been trained on without any restrictions, whereas Adobe has been trained on their own little data set.
It's an interesting thing. I mean, I think just the pure fact that we're talking about a technology being trained on something, as right. opposed to like, oh, we've written an algorithm and now all of a sudden it can blur skin,
right?
You know, which in a sense, it's a completely different, it's a completely different approach.
It is crazy. The reason why I say that, because 3 or 4 years ago, I used to do a class and I used to teach something like, let's say, sharpening. All right. And if you missed focus in a particular area, I would say that what sharpening does in photography and digital images, imaging, is that it adds contrast along the edges. And it tries to create an illusion that the image is sharp, and it doesn't create the details. And I explained it. Your computer can never create details. You can only create the illusion of sharpening. Or if you have lost details in some place, you have to, you know, get the details from some other image and paste it there and try to match it, like we usually do in Photoshop. The image, Photoshop cannot create the details. It doesn't know what was there. But I was proven wrong, flabbergasted, and it was thrown all over the place when generative AI was released. Let's say if we had to remove something, replace something, or change something in our image, all we had was the clone stamp tool or the patch tool or stuff like that. We had other images that we took reference from, copied different parts, but now we have this amazing tool that, you know, generates something of its own. And that is just thinking about it, just the thought of it is insane.
Yeah, and it's very similar to upscaling imagery, for example.
Right.
You know, I used to say this, you know, it's like, well, you know, if you don't have any more pixels, you can't just pull them out of thin air. Well, turns out
exactly.
You
can. You can right now. It is insane. I used to say the same about upscaling, now that you say it. Right.
It's a crazy thing. Now, one of the most sort of more acute discussions that I come across, especially in the world of like photo competitions, for example, is this whole thing in conjunction with generative AI, you know, where basically, you know, where people are not really very clear on, you know, what happens when you use generative AI, because let's say you erase a thing. Like I did a thing where I had, you know, a car and it was decals on the side, and I erased the decals, right? I just replaced them with just plain paintwork.
Cars. Okay.
Yeah. Simple thing. I mean, it would have been absolutely possible in Photoshop before. Obviously, it would have been relatively easy to do, but it would have taken a little bit of time, like a minute or two, right? Now, it takes absolutely zero time, and the results are pretty phenomenal. You know, and the difference being that previously I would have cloned things in, let's say, from another part of the image. So if I was the photographer, then since I would have taken the original image, I would have now reused other pixels that I had already created, in a sense. So even though I'm copying stuff over, I'm still the original author of that part of the image, if that makes any sense.
Right.
The discussion with AI and generative fill is now that, well, but now AI just makes stuff up. So it fills that area in with stuff that you didn't shoot as a photographer. So now that part of the image isn't actually your own. And therefore, you can now not enter it into a photo competition, since the definition is all the parts of the image had to have been generated by the photographer. And it's like, you know, I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, yeah, but the end result's exactly the same. I mean, it looks exactly the same.
It's a critical thing to think about. And it's insane, because when you use generative fill, it also looks at your image and looks for reference. It is not that it takes something else and just pastes it there. It just uses your image so that it matches perfectly. So I don't know what to think about it, because there are other tools too. For example, if you use something like the remove tool that is new to Photoshop, it also uses AI. But then again, it doesn't generate something of its own. It takes things from your image and tries to do it. So it is all about, where do we draw the line? That is the whole crux of the thing, because what sort of AI are you allowed to use? And it just is insane.
It's getting insanely complicated, you know. My wife always calls it the fluffy bit. You know, it's like whenever something changes and people get all, you know, up in arms about it, and you know, and there's still a discussion and argument or whatever. It's just a fluffy bit until people get used to it. I mean, I'm imagining it'd be the same as when, you know, Photoshop first came around and people went like, well, hang on, but that's not, no, you can't do that because you can't do that in a dark room. We've never been able to do this before. So now that's not photography is what I hear all the time.
That's not photography, yeah. But this AI feels a bit different because it is generating something of its own. Up until now, whatever we did, it was not generating something of its own. It was not, this is a different beast. Like even what we were doing in Photoshop, that was meticulously done by us by hand. That was kind of a digital art that we were creating. Even if we were modifying something, we took the effort to do it. But now that we are using AI, it is creating something on its own. The machine is creating something on its own. And that's where the difference comes into place. And I really don't know what to think about it. Really don't know how the ownership goes, but I do know the technicalities of it. So you said you replaced that little area of your car. So what happens is now when you export that image from Photoshop, some content credentials will be added to it. It will be tagged that AI was used in this photo. So when you next open that exported image somewhere else, even in Photoshop or other places, it will have that tag that says that you have used AI in this photo.
Even on Instagram, I see recently. So right. Now if you upload an image to Instagram, it will now have a little tag that says created with AI, even though not really, it's just that I erased a sticker on the side of the car or something.
Right. Right. But, and again, it's not something that, you know, you cannot remove. Like just take a screenshot or just select the whole image and paste it in a new document and it goes away. It's not that it's a foolproof solution that Adobe has come up with, but you know, it just, the ownership is kind of a gray area with that.
So there's a flip side of that. Mm. And that's coming from the purely creative point of view. Mm. So I wonder if you agree with me on this. So I always think that if I just look at AI as yet another tool, a really powerful tool, and one that apparently needs to be trained a little bit like my dog for some reason, so it can do a trick or two, you know. Nevertheless, a really extremely powerful tool. What it does do creatively is it allows me to convert what's in my head and turn that into a tangible image on the screen. And it allows me to do that quicker and better and faster than ever before. So it's like, from a creative perspective entirely, it's like a magic.
Thank you so much for tuning in. If you enjoyed that clip, then press here for the full episode in glorious Technicolor. Hey, and don't forget to subscribe.